I challenged myself to build a fast backtesting system. By the end of this week, I wanted to have a first yet very simplistic version of it. But the path to that goal was way harder than I expected. My plan was to use so-called vector operations, which are extremely fast compared to looping over an entire dataset. But coding those vector operations is not that easy. While working through this problem, I think I might have hit an impossible edge case. How I overcame this problem and still achieved a great performance is what I will show you in this episode of my series From Zero to Algo Trader. Quick recap. In the last episode, I built the foundation to get data, calculate indicators, and generate buy and sell signals. To ensure everything truly worked as expected, I wrote some unit tests. This turned out to be a really good idea, because I realized I hadn't accounted for none values in my signals module. The problem: none values can generate four signals, and the test revealed this issue. Those none values often come up when the indicators are calculated over some range or window, like a moving average. That's because for the beginning of the dataset, the first few values can't be calculated. This is the case until the number of rows reaches the required window size. So for an SMA with a window size of 10, the first 9 data points will be none. To handle this, I applied a validation mask over the signal, ensuring that any none values would default to false, and therefore prevent false triggers. After implementing this fix, I ran all the tests again. And now every single one passes. So a buy signal means buy, and a sell signal means sell. It's that easy, right? Sadly, it's not. The problem is, the signals are not clean. What does that mean? Generally, we want alternating buy and sell signals on the timeline. A buy followed by a sell, and then another buy, and so on. But depending on the strategy, that's not always the case. Some strategies might generate multiple buy signals before a sell comes, or multiple sell signals before the next buy. If our signals were always this clean, we could fully vectorize the process. But I want a framework that works for a wide variety of strategies and isn't limited to just this pattern. And since I haven't figured out a way to vectorize this cleaning process, and I'm not even sure if it's possible, I think I'm forced to use a looping approach to clean up these signals. So I need to find a way to at least make these loops as fast as possible so it doesn't inflate the entire backtesting time.
We started out looping with iterrows, which you should pretty much almost never do. We moved to looping with apply, which is a fairly efficient way to loop through things.
Look, here's what I came up with. I'm doing a performance test with 1 million rows of random buy and sell signals. A simple function like this one can clean the signals and tell us if we are in a current position. Using iterrows to iterate through the 1 million rows and apply this function to every single one takes about 9 seconds. That's not great at all. So let's see if we can speed that up. Let's use the same function, but this time use the pandas apply function. That's definitely a lot faster, but still takes around 2.3 seconds to calculate. Now let's try to use some NumPy magic to juggle the numbers a bit and take advantage of the ffill function. First, we generate a NumPy array where the value is 1 whenever there is a buy signal and -1 when there is a sell signal, and otherwise it's NaN. Next, we apply ffill to forward fill the 1 and -1 values. Any remaining NaN values at the beginning are set to -1, meaning that we are not in a position. Now we can move the numbers a bit around. First we add 1 to the series, and then we divide it by 2. This trick gives us a series of 1s and 0s, which can be turned back into booleans of true and false values. So, was it worth the effort? Let's run another performance test. Just about 10.5 milliseconds. That's 219 times faster compared to the apply method and 879 times faster compared to the iterrows version. That's insane. Did you expect such a great improvement? Let me know in the comments. Let's add this version to the framework. Now Now let's walk through the entire backtesting process to see it in action. First, I pull the data from my database. With this data, I can calculate indicators like the simple moving average. Then I generate buy and sell signals based on these indicators. For example, a buy signal occurs when the close price is above the SMA 20 and the SMA 10 crosses above the SMA 20. And a sell signal is triggered when the SMA 10 crosses below the SMA 20. Finally, my new portfolio class cleans up the signals and calculates the profit. And here are the results. But keep in mind, these results don't yet account for fees or slippage, so they aren't fully realistic. So there is still a lot of work to do. But that's something we will tackle in the next episodes. See you then.